How could a good God allow suffering in the world? For many people, it's not the exclusivity of Christianity that presents the greatest objection to the possibility of belief in God. It's this one right here, a very real, felt problem that we face in our lives and in the world today. Some people find unjust suffering to be a philosophical problem, calling into question the very existence of God. Yet for many people, I would say maybe for most of us, this is an intensely personal issue. People don't care about the abstract question about whether God exists or not. They simply refuse to believe or to trust in a God that allows human history to unfold as it does. For many people, the problem of good and evil, or the problem of God and evil, presents a real problem for belief in God. I just want to welcome you. Welcome to a new year. Welcome into the Redeemer community. We are entering into a two-month study in the book of Job in the next couple of weeks. And as we go into the book of Job, we're going to get to see real life situations of a holy and good God allowing a good, righteous man to suffer, and to suffer a lot. As we go into the book of Job, we'll get to see some of the themes that I want to introduce to you today played out in real time. That's where we're going in the days ahead. Redeemer does exist to help connect Jesus to people, people to community, and community to mission. And maybe, just maybe, you could connect with God and you could connect with this local church community by considering the problem of pain in the world. Let me give you an example of the problem. December 2004, a massive tsunami killed more than 250,000 people around the rim of the Indian Ocean. Over the following weeks, newspapers and magazines were full of letters and articles asking, "Where is God?" One reporter wrote, "If God is God, then he is not good. And if God is good, then he is not God. You can't have it both ways, especially after the Indian Ocean catastrophe." Now, despite the confident assertion of the columnist, the effort to demonstrate that evil disproves the existence of God is now acknowledged by almost all sides to be completely bankrupt. So what are we dealing in? What are we dealing in right here, and where are we going for the next couple of months? Three very basic ideas, and the first one is this: evil and suffering isn't evidence against God. Think about it. The claim against God goes like this: if a good and powerful God exists, then he would not allow pointless evil in his world. But because there is so much unjustifiable, hard to explain, pointless evil in the world, the traditional good and powerful God could not exist. Some other God or some other not God may exist, but not the traditional good and loving God. Said another way, this implies an enormous faith in one's own cognitive abilities. Someone might say, well, just think about it. If our minds can't plumb the depths of the universe to understand God and suffering, then there can't be anything. But this is a blind faith. Our own experience tells us that we can actually learn from our sufferings. Yes, there may be many, but they might not actually be pointless. Consider the words from Romans chapter 8, verses 18 to 21. We set those on the screen just here. Christians can affirm the presence of both sufferings and a good God who is working out his purposes in the midst of those sufferings. But is this reasonable to do? Many people have a problem with God because of the presence of evil and suffering. But consider from the Bible, and then maybe we could get there from our own human experience, about why God allows so much evil and suffering in the world. Think of the life of Joseph in the Old Testament, discovered in Genesis chapter 37 to 50. Joseph was an arrogant young man who hated his brothers. In their anger against him, they imprisoned him in a pit, then they sold him into slavery in Egypt. Joseph must have prayed to God, but obviously he didn't receive any help. Into slavery he went. He experienced years of bondage and misery, but in the midst of that, his character was actually being refined and even transformed. He rose up to become the premier, and he saved millions of people from starvation, including his own family. Now consider, how could God actually be at work in the midst of this? One might be able to say, well, if God didn't allow him to endure the suffering, then he wouldn't have become such a powerful agent for social healing and social justice. You see, this is a narrative that people can identify with. Many people admit that what they've most needed, when they most needed success, came difficult experiences. Other people say that none of us are grateful for the tragedies, but we wouldn't trade the insights we've gained from them. With time and perspective, many of us can see actually good that has come from the tough things that have come our way. Think about it in our own lives, in our relationships, and in our workplaces. It's actually those tough moments when we've been confronted by a boss or a spouse, a family member, coworker, or friend, that we actually learn things through the difficulty. We're actually able to refine and even be transformed into being a different kind of person. So why then would it not be possible? From God's vantage point, could God not have reasons for our trials? Could God not have reasons for our sufferings that we endure? You see, when you think about it in this way, evil and suffering isn't necessarily evidence against God. If anything, and this might be the most provocative thing that I say for a while, evil and suffering may actually be evidence for God. Horrendous, unexplainable suffering, though it cannot disprove God, it is a problem for people who claim to worship God. But consider this, my friend. It might actually be an even greater problem for people who do not believe in God. Consider the medievalist philosopher from Oxford, C.S. Lewis. He attested to this. He originally rejected the idea of God because of the cruelty of life. Then he came to realize that evil was even more problematic in his atheism. In the end, he realized that suffering provided a better argument for God's existence than it did as an argument against the existence of God. Here's the words of C.S. Lewis. You can read them for yourself. He says, "My argument against God was that the universe seemed cruel and unjust. But how had I got this idea of just and unjust? What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? Of course, I could have given up my idea of justice by saying that it was nothing but a private idea of my own. But if I did that, then my argument against God would have collapsed too. For the argument depended on saying that the world was really unjust, not simply that it did not happen to please my private fancies. Consequently, atheism turns out to be too simple." Think about it. Lewis recognized the modern objections to God are based on a sense of fair play and justice. People we believe ought not to suffer. People we believe ought not to be excluded. People we believe ought not to die of hunger or oppression. Such thinking forces us to honestly uncover our foundational ideas. Where do we come up with these concepts? If we are sure that this natural world is unjust and filled with evil, then you are assuming that reality is supernatural. It has some supernatural standard by which it could be judged. In short, the problem of tragedy, the problem of suffering, the problem of pain, the problem of injustice is a problem for everyone. It is at least a problem for non-belief in God as much as it's a problem for belief in God. So it is a mistake, therefore, and an understandable mistake, to think that if you abandon belief in God, somehow this makes the problem of evil and disaster easier to come by. It doesn't. It makes it actually more difficult. Because consider the truth of Romans chapter 8, verse 28. It says, "And we know that in all things God works for good for those who love him and who have been called according to his purposes." So in all things, in the pains, in the tragedies, in the trials, and in the disasters, the Christian has God, who is working all of that out to turn out for good for those who love him and who have been called according to his purposes. Consider Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and earth had passed away, and I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God." Think about this. "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be any mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." So we've considered, firstly, that evil and suffering isn't necessarily evidence against God. If anything, with the medievalist philosopher C.S. Lewis, we consider that evil and suffering may actually be evidence for God. Consider where this leaves us. Though Christianity does not provide the reason for each experience of pain, it does provide deep resources for actually facing suffering with hope and courage rather than bitterness and despair. And this is because God, the God that the Christian worships, is the ultimate sufferer. Someone might say that all of this philosophizing doesn't really get God off the hook for the world's evil and suffering. In response to this, the philosopher Peter Kreeft points out that the Christian God came to earth to deliberately put himself on the hook of our human suffering. Think about it, friend. In Jesus Christ, God experienced the greatest depth of pain, not simply in some marginal, unjustifiable way. He experienced this for us. This is where Christianity offers resources for facing the suffering. Consider the absolutely shaken Jesus as he was preparing to die. The Bible clearly shows that Jesus did not face his approaching death with spiritual courage in the face of such persecution. Jesus is depicted as profoundly shaking by his impending doom on the cross. He says, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," in Mark 14, 33 and 34. Luke describes him as a man with all the signs of physical shock in Luke chapter 22, verse 44. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all reveal a man that is trying to avoid death. But then he says, "If it be your will, take this cup from me." Jesus cries out from the cross that God had forsaken him, and he suffered a 3.5-hour terrible death of suffocation and blood loss. Why? Why was Jesus overwhelmed by his death? Well, consider why he came. Jesus came to be our Redeemer. The sufferings of Jesus are qualitatively different than every other form of death. Physical pain was nothing compared to the experience of cosmic abandonment. Christianity alone claims that God became human and he knew firsthand despair, rejection, loneliness, poverty, bereavement, torture, and imprisonment. On the cross, he went beyond the worst human suffering to experience cosmic rejection and pain that exceeds ours. So think about it, my friend. In the midst of our pain and in the midst of our suffering, in his death, God suffers in love, identifying with the abandoned and forsaken. Why? Because Jesus had to pay for our sins, so one day Jesus can do away with our sin and our suffering without doing away with us. This is where Christianity offers more than consolation for the suffering. Christianity offers restoration for the suffering. This brings us to a place when we consider all of the suffering and pain in the world and we look around, we wonder, why does God let this happen? We look to the cross and we see what the answer simply cannot be. The answer cannot be that he does not love us. Because when we look to the cross, we see Jesus willingly laying his life down to endure the worst sort of suffering that any of us could have ever had come our way. Our sin against a holy God. He willingly lays his life down. He takes our suffering so seriously that he took it onto himself. This is where Christianity offers a deep consolation for us in the midst of our pains. Jesus is truly God, Emmanuel, God with us, who we celebrate at Christmas, but Christianity offers more. Christianity offers a full restoration for our suffering and our pain as well. Because the future is not some immaterial paradise, but a new heavens and a new earth. The future is not people being taken out of this world and into heaven. The future is heaven coming down to cleanse, purify, and heal this world altogether. Christianity offers something for our pain and suffering that nothing else can. The secular view offers no restoration after death or future history. Eastern religions believe that we lose our actual selves and return to some all soul and we're gone altogether in the end. Even religions with a heavenly paradise consider it a consolation for what might have been. Only the biblical view of restoration through resurrection. Not a consolation for what we've lost, but a full restoration for what we've always longed for. This is what Christianity offers, and this is where we're going in the days ahead in the book of Job. The presence of suffering in the world is a real problem for all of us, but reflecting on our frustrations can lead us to consider who God is, and there we might find Christianity, offering real resources to help us make it through our sufferings, most notably a Savior who enters into them for us. So won't you join us in the days ahead as we study this in the book of Job?